Hey, what's up? I'm here to talk about the process that I went into making my 3D model. So let's take a quick look at it. Here's the Blender file itself. I made multiple scenes for it, so each scene has its own file, but once the model itself was finished, it was just a matter of creating a duplicate file and then messing around with the lighting and the camera and obviously the background. And looking at just the model, the 3D modeling aspect of the blue whale itself, this is how it kind of started out. You can kind of see these are the models that you saw in the beginning of the intro. If you tap into it, and these lines are just highlighted so that they show up in the final render as freestyle lines. I have that turned off right now, but if you just click that, they'll show up in the actual render. But this is just like a mirrored object. It started off very, very simple, just getting the shape right for what the whale is, using my reference images heavily to get all the details right, trying to make it look as realistic as possible. And if you look at the final version of the model, it looks very similar to what this reference image is, and that's just a testament just to how good that image is, really. But there's also a top-down view, and if I turn off the model, you can see what I mean. It really helps highlight three-dimensional aspects of the whale as to where the creases are for the blowhole, where there's like volume in the back of the spine, and where there's this edge that travels all the way back down to the tail. All those little details really help sell the realistic factor, and getting it right helps to make it look as best as it can. So the first model was just kind of very simple, get the basic shape down. The second version of the model, I added a subdivision modifier to kind of take off all those creases of the edges. If I turn it off, you can kind of see what it looks like. And there's also a shade smooth happening right there. But added more detail to it, added more lines, trying to keep in mind as to where it's going to be bending. Where would a whale naturally bend as it moves? And making sure that's where I'm putting all those creases, but then also making sure that I'm putting space for where the eye is going to be, where the flippers are going to go, and where the tail is going to go, making sure that those loops are exactly where they need to be. So then that was version two. Version three starts to look into even more detail. And then unfortunately, that's as far as the process I have saved, because after model three, I really took a huge leap into adding details such as the flippers, this kind of back dorsal fin, and the blowhole, and adding volume to the edges. So it really looks like a three-dimensional creature. And also, this was rather tricky. I knew ahead of time that the mouth was going to be moving up and down, so I had to make sure that I'm modeling it, knowing that there's going to be creases here, that there's going to have to be movement there, knowing that there's going to have to be movement at the flippers, and knowing there's going to be movement here at the back of the tail. So as you're modeling, keeping all that in mind and being very aware of the fact of where you're putting the loops, so that ultimately when it's animating, it's not breaking the model and it doesn't look unnatural. And I think it succeeded. Let's take a look at what it looks like without that subdivision modifier. Kind of looks like a PlayStation 1 model. Can see how much work just that one modifier is doing. It's just kind of crazy. Actually, can I watch it get animated? Yeah, there you go. It's looking good. But you can see details like the ridges are created by texture work, and I can look into how that was made. So these are actual two textures that are interacting with one another. I created a mask. If you look at the nodes, put this down and put this up and put this to the right. These are the two textures that we're looking at. There's a whale skin color, and then there's a white shark skin color. And I use that also for the bump map so that you could create these texturing effects, even though there is no modeling there going on. Like if you switch over to flat surface mode, this is just what's actually there, and you can see how much work the texturing is doing. But yeah, you put those together, and then you use a mix shader and use a factor node to create a texture mask. And in the texture mask, let's take a look at that. I've got all the vertices selected. So if you go into texture paint, that is the texture mask right there with all the UVs placed. And you see everywhere that it's white, it's gonna be rendering out this texture and its bump map. And then everywhere that's black, it's gonna be rendering that other texture. And so you can kind of paint directly onto the model and decide where that texture is gonna be shown. Another detail to add to the realism factor was the fake caustics that are kind of glowing on the top of the whale, and that was done also with a set of nodes. And I can link to the tutorial that I used to help me with this because it is quite complicated, but essentially it's two Voronoi textures filtered through a distance node, and then it's all about keyframing the actual mapping node so that when it when it's being animated, it's actually moving. Makes it look like the sunlight is reflecting. Something that you'll notice is that the whale model itself is actually just standing still. It's standing completely in place. The only thing that's actually moving is the camera. And let me highlight the camera so you can take a look at that. There it is. And let's go to the beginning of the animation. And you can see when you press play, the model itself, let's turn off the ocean so you can see it faster. There you go. The model itself is standing still, but the camera is the one that's making all the movement. Something else to give it a realistic effect is these light rays, and that is just a 2D plane with a alpha node filter. Let's see if I can show that. There it is. If you look at the actual image itself, it's just a black and white image where the black itself is turned into an alpha layer so that it's hidden. And it disappears into the background, and it just looks like these light rays. But that wasn't quite enough for me, so I actually like the look of the light rays being animated. Even though it's a 2D static image, you can go in and add an extra noise texture effect, and you can animate that with keyframes as well, and it'll make it look like it's sunlight dancing in the light rays, which is pretty cool. Another effect that I kind of hid just now was the ocean. The ocean itself has its own fake caustics. This was kind of easy to replicate. I just took the nodes that I added to the whale. You take those effects and then you can put that on any surface whatsoever. And so if you zoom in on this, you can see the exact same effect is happening here. And again, giving it movement, giving the illusion that the model is moving. And then the final thing to give it that, there's two more, it are these particles. And if you look at the particle zero, you can take a look at what that actually looks like. And it's just this simple polygonal shape, that's multiplied over and over again and then given physics. And so that it has no gravity, so it's floating there, and then you add this force effect layer to it, and it makes those particle effects move, and it gives that extra added oomph, or if you look at it here, making it appear as if you're moving through the ocean. It's kind of subtle, but it really sells the effect. And of course you've got the background, which is a gradient effect. You can take a look at the notes that I made there. This was just really messing around with the gradient effects. There's a spherical node happening here, as well as a linear, and then I'm mixing them into the principled volume. And the principled volume is what gives it this atmosphere, and it's super effective. It took it off right there. You see how much work it's doing. Yeah, and choosing the right colors to give it that look of under the ocean using references image. I found some images online, and you can view at it from an angle, top view, and front view. It really helped sell all the details to making this model look as realistic as possible. And there's the eye. A whole nother video that I found of that's a tutorial that helped me make a human eye, but then I looked at reference images for what whale eyes look like, and their pupils are significantly larger, so kind of just copied that. And you can see that the texture that I found for the whale skin is actually pretty low quality, but keep the camera far enough away and the effect still works. It's got all those little dimples and bump maps to sell the little lighting effects to make it look as if it's actual skin. One thing that I also wanted to mention was the scene with the sunset. You can look at it here. Well, it was somewhat tricky because at first I just had it with an HDRI background, but then I realized to give it that effect of it really looks like you're moving through the sky, I wanted to add all these clouds. And volumetrics for clouds are a little tricky and I haven't really fully explored it yet, so I wanted to see if I could sell the effect with just these 2D alpha images of clouds. And I went into Photoshop and changed the colors so that they could match with the actual scene itself, and then animated them to follow the camera. And I think the effect turned out really well. But yeah, the whole purpose of this project was to learn how to animate, and that's where this IK rig or inverse kinematic rig comes into play. And we can take a look at it, put it into pose mode. And this was a homemade or custom rig for it, where I put one bone down, extruded it, and tried to match it with where the spine would be, trying to imagine what an actual skeleton of the whale would be. And then actually animating it, I looked at reference images of videos of just blue whales swimming and trying to match with that. And it looked, first time that I went through it, it looked really janky. I'm gonna put the video of that right here. But then I realized that you can actually take existing animation, and these are all the keyframes. These are repeating. I made a loop. Only the first 220 are the ones that I hand animated myself, and then I just repeated to have it become a looping animation. It looked kind of janky, and I realized that what you can do is go to view. Once you've got your keyframes highlighted, instead of looking at the timeline, you can actually go to graph editor. Press A to select all of them in case you haven't. Go into interpolation mode and turn on Bezier so that each individual keyframe is actually going through a Bezier curve, thus making the transition from each keyframe a lot more smooth. You can also go into smooth keys. Pressing Alt O and doing that repeatedly will eventually, if you do it too much, it'll like smooth it out way too much, and then the whale itself won't be moving anymore. But if you do it two or three times, it'll smooth those transitions even more. So yeah, and now it looks like this, which I think it turned out really well. One other thing to keep in mind is getting the weight for it right. And by that I mean when you pair a meta rig to a 3D model, you can pair to it using something that's called, click that first, and then the something that's called automatic weights. And what that does is that it pairs the model automatically to what it believes the hierarchy of the bones are. And I can show you what that means better by looking at it visually. So go into weight paint mode. You can look at each individual bone. That's the IK rig, so it's affecting the entire model. Clicking on each individual bone highlights just how much effect it's going to be having on the model, and that's what happens when you click on the automatic weights. But you can actually go into this and edit the weights by going into your tool and going into your brushes, and you can delete some of it by going into changing the brush into subtract mode, or adding more to it by pretty much going into any other one, but I like to go into mix, and making sure that you turn on auto normalize. That way, so if you delete some weights on one, it automatically adds it to the next bone over. That can be kind of tricky, so if things are not looking well, turn that off, but I like to keep it on. So in subtract mode, let's say, like for example, when I first automatically tied the rig to the model, the mouth was not working as it should, and when I opened it, it was moving the entire head forward, so I had to go in and manually make it so that this bone was only affecting the mouth and nothing else. And then when you go back into object mode and then go into pose, it works as intended. And with each movement, you can add a new keyframe so that you're animating. And if at any point you mess up or you hate how it looks, you can select all the bones and then press Alt G to remove them to their original places, and then Alt R to reset the rotation for all the bones. and then you can set a new keyframe and start all over if you want. I had to do this multiple times just to get it right, because I was not liking how it was looking. There's a lot more that I learned about animation, but I can make, you can make just one video about this alone. I'll add a tutorial that I learned a lot from in the description as well. But yeah, that's about it. Thanks for watching, and subscribe if you want to see more. Catch you later. Testing. Actually, I already did my testing. Oh, this is terrifying. Hey, how's it going? Blah, blah, blah. Oh, okay. Hey, what's up? I'm here to talk about the process that I went into making my 3D model. So let's take a quick look at it first.